I have got some new books that I'm reading for December. It's a bit late, I know, during the month to kind of introduce some new books in there. I was spending most of my time, especially October and November, catching up on books that I hadn't kind of got around to reading. I'm not somebody that has to read every single book from the front to the back. I don't subscribe to that. I think some books, especially the books that I buy, especially if they're in the nonfiction side of things, they do tend to kind of repeat the same sort of argument once they've kind of set forth their argument and they've kind of argued for and against the position that they have and they presented some corroborating evidence and some evidence that is against what they're talking about. It kind of does divulge into a bit of a spiral of repeating yourself and making the same argument and countering an argument again and again and again and again. The greatest books in the world don't do that, and they're able to kind of weave a narrative through that, but some of the books are the kind of a bit samey. So the idea of kind of like dumping a book and saying, you know what, I've read this and I think this is enough and I've got the gist of it is good, because I'd rather read the book and get the gist of it and kind of extract the value that I can out of it than, you know, brutalize myself by trying to get through a book that is just not vibing with me. And sometimes it happens that you read a book and in later years it then kind of resonates with you a few years later. It's something that you don't kind of like, it doesn't kind of like click with you at the moment, but you need to kind of give it a break and come back to it. I'm assuming the same thing happens with movies, happens with TV series, happens with music sometimes. Like you listen to an artist, you're like, you know what, I don't really like he or she, but then you come back later, you're like, you know what, I actually get all the hype now, I understand it, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, I spent most of my October and my November catching up on those books. Some of them are great, some of them are bad. Some of the great ones that I've kind of just about finished is this, Flash Boys by Michael Lewis, which is an incredible book that kind of details the stock exchange meltdown during kind of the early 2000s and what kind of transpired and what kind of caused that kind of blackout. So I recommend you check that if you're in kind of curious about, you know, things that, all things concerning the stock exchange and what happened there in the mid 2000s. I recommend you check that out too. But the books I have for this month are as follows. Oh, it's always nice getting books from Amazon, isn't it? They do well to fucking package them. Oh, this was bent actually, but anyway, get these all up here. So got these four books here, as you can see. I'm gonna put it up to the camera. I'm interested there. There they are there. Get a good little what's that thing called? A thumbnail for the video later. Got a good little picture there, like, aha! You know that surprise face everyone puts on YouTube. But anyway, doesn't really matter for audio listeners. But anyway, so I've got four books here that I'm trying to read through the month of December. Now, it's not that I need to finish them all by December, but my aim is to try and get most of them finished by December. As you can see, there's a fair amount of paper there. About, I think I calculated, it's just over 2,000 pages front to back in all these books. So it's going to be a lot to get through. But as always, you know, it's always good to set yourself little stretch goals to achieve. And stuff like reading is kind of similar to any sort of other hobby you might have. In order to kind of give it as much time as it needs to, you know, in order to kind of reach the goal that you want, you have to eliminate other things. You have to kind of prioritize. You have to sacrifice some things. So I might not be on my phone as much. I might not be on the internet as much. I might not be listening to podcasts as much. There's things that I have to sacrifice. Or like, for instance, like now in the, like, I basically read 2 hours a day. The first thing I grab in the morning is a book. So once I'm waking up, before I'm going to go to the gym, I'll have a book on the side of my bed. I'll turn the bedside lamp on and just start reading a few pages for an hour or so. In the morning's a bit difficult because I'm quite groggy, but I just try and wake myself up with some, you know, with some good reading material. And then in the evening, I'll read for an hour and then maybe an hour extra. So I might read for another 2 hours. So about 3 hours of reading each day. Now, it's a little bit easier if you've got a commute to work and stuff. You could actually cheat. So imagine I could have... I can read for an hour in the morning and then I can read again another hour to work, and then that's another hour maybe at lunchtime, and then on the way back you're another hour. So you're kind of cheating all the little commute options that you're doing. It's a good little way to cheat. And the other day when I went to go do my food shopping in Lidl, because it's always fucking super rammed in there and the queue's always super long, I just took a book with me instead of taking a podcast and just kind of read a few pages on the, you know, in the queue when you're in the stores and stuff. It's a bit weird, you know, because no one reads books anymore. So when you are reading in public, people always look at you and give you the kind of side eye, like as if like you think you're smarter than everyone, which obviously I think I am. It's always a bit strange, isn't it? You get more looks from strangers reading a book than you would do anything else. It's fucking bizarre, isn't it? I guess because it's such an old school way of kind of consuming information, and there's there's probably not that many of us out there that are, you know, consistently buying books and shit. I understand that in some respect, but it can get a bit annoying. But hey, ho, what can you do? Anyway, I've got four books here. Number one book that I've got here is Noam Chomsky, Who Rules the World. Brief synopsis on the book is Who Rules the World is Noam Chomsky's rigorous examination of the dark currents underlying some of the major issues of our times. From the secret history of the US to Cuba, to China's global ascent, from torture memos to sanctions to on Iran, he explores how the United States talk of freedom and human rights is often at odds with its actions. Delving deep into the conflicts of Iraq, Afghanistan, Israel, Palestine, he offers terrifying picture of the inner and outer workings of modern day imperial power. This already I've started reading. I'm about three quarters away through, as you can see from the bunny ears here. An incredible book so far. It's weird because it mentions a couple of books I already got in my collection, like the Robert Frist book that kind of details the rise of Al-Qaeda, so it kind of ties in a lot of that too. So I recommend you check that as well. You know, Noam Chomsky is one of our foremost leading public intellectuals out there. I've got this book called A Little Life, which I had on my reading list for a while, and I feel a few people on my Instagram have commented that it was a bit of a slow, long read, but it's a bit of fiction, so which I don't necessarily read, so I'm intrigued to kind of get through this at the moment. I haven't read any backstory to it. I've seen a few people on my Instagram say, oh, it's a really long read, it's really slow and laborious, but I purposely not looked into what the book's about. I just want to kind of go into it blind, so that's going to be something I'm going to be eager to kind of delve into. And usually fiction books, I'm quite good at kind of tearing through them really quickly. I kind of read it like a movie. I'm always really curious, so, oh, what's going to be the next chapter, what's going on? So that should be pretty easy to read. Then I've got Chasing the Scream by Johan Harari, however you pronounce his name. He's been on a bit of a speaking tour as of late because he's got a book out recently that kind of deals with mental health, I think, because he's been suffering those issues at the moment. I think that's a book at the moment. I think he's got an interview at the moment recently with Sam Harris, so maybe check that out. You can want to know who he is. But a brief synopsis of this at the back, it says, drugs are not what we think they are. Addiction is not what we think it is. And the war on drugs is not what we see on our TV screens. In Chasing the Scream, Johan Harari shares his discoveries through the riveting stories he uncovered on a 30,000-mile journey from the founder of the war on drugs who stalked and killed Billie Holiday to transgender crack dealer in Brooklyn to the only country that has ever decriminalized all drugs with remarkable results. You will never look at addiction or our society in the same way again. They do that in Portugal, right? Portugal's legalized, I think, most personal consumption of drugs, right? So if you've got like an amount, I think it might be under 7 grams, then you can carry it, you know what I mean, for all class A drugs. And they've kind of cracked that mold, so that might be a good way to place to go for the summer holidays and for some of you motherfuckers. But yeah, so that's cool. And obviously, the, you know, I'm always intrigued about reading kind of books that kind of detail the failings of the war on drugs and just the whole drug economy for the most part, because it ties into so many facets of our of society that, you know, unless from the outside looking in, you just think it's a couple of back gang bangers that are just, you know, fucking it up for everyone. But the octopus tentacles of the drug game run deep. Once you read those kind of books, like I said, if you read Roberto Saviano's 000, which I have somewhere around here, it kind of details that a lot. I think I've got it down here, actually, down there. 000, Roberto Saviano, who's also the person that wrote the original book called Gomorra, which is an Italian TV series. I think that was on Sky Atlantic. That's fucking amazing. If you like The Sopranos and you want to see a real authentic version, or if you like Narcos, for instance, and you want to see like an Italian version or European version of Narcos, I recommend you check out Gomorra. It's fucking incredible. And then last but not least, I've got The Laws of Human Nature by Robert Greene. I've mentioned this a few times because obviously I've got Mastery by Robert Greene. I've got 48 Laws of Power, which is up here too. One of my other favorite books as well. But yeah, I'm a big fan of Robert Greene. His books are always fucking riveting, always amazing. I thought Mastery was one of my favorites from him, kind of detailing masters over in different fields and kind of breaking down systematically just what it takes in order to be a master in that kind of field and kind of demystifying it. Like, it's not just all like some there are aliens do exist, right? Lionel Messi's do exist, but for the most part, most of us can turn ourselves into kind of worst class performance within our domain of expertise if we kind of are methodical in our approach. You know, we commit the necessary time in order to kind of get better at it, we are critical of our work, we're able to kind of step back from it, blah 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 blah. There's loads of things I really can check that out. And Laws of Human Nature is obviously an extension of all those kind of books now. At the back, Reece Nussle, it says here, you're about to become an apprentice in human nature. First, the laws will work to transform you into a calmer, more strategic observer of people, helping you to free from all the emotional drama that needs to strain you, which I think I'm fairly okay at doing at the moment, but, you know, it's always good to kind of learn further about a certain subject. Second, the laws will make you a master interpreter of the cues that people continually emit, giving you a much greater ability to judge their character, which is perfecto. Third, the laws will empower you to take on and outthink the toxic types who have inevitably crossed your path, which is very, very apt to me at the moment. And then fourth, the laws will teach you the true levers for motivating and influencing people, which is something that I've kind of struggled with a lot. I've mentioned it a few times about not trying to be too rah-rah with some people, not always trying to solve other people's problems and allowing them to kind of go through their own shit. All those kind of things I've kind of mentioned previously in the past. And then fifth is the laws will give you the power to alter your own negative patterns, which obviously is again something that I need to do. So yeah, so there's four books I'm reading for this month. I cannot wait to get started. I've already started on a few of them now at the moment, so that's four there. Big baby babies. Reading is fucking amazing. I actually love it. It's one of my favorite hobbies I have at the moment. It's really good. It's just really a good exercise of calming the mind. I've already been quite good with the whole social media stuff. I kind of post and dump on Instagram. I check in sporadically from here down on Facebook, which is weird, isn't it? Because most people my age are mostly on Instagram, but I mostly spend my time on Twitter and Facebook, which is fucking crazy. But even there, I kind of check in, check out, and I've kind of done a good job of it. But reading does really help in terms of allowing me to kind of step away and unplug from all that social media malarkey.